City Market was the goal, and by October we opened. I'm a Liberian American. I grew up outside Atlanta. I lived in Liberia for 10 years, and that's where I started my company, and I've just moved back in order to open this store. The goal was to be Liberian Oprah Winfrey. I intended to do more communications work in West Africa, travel around, get the stories. And I fell into the fashion. I started making dresses in 2011, and I sold my first batch of dresses here in Atlanta at my friend's studio off Peter Street. And I went back, and people were actually interested in paying for design, which is something I didn't think people were interested in doing in West Africa. So I opened my first boutique in 2013 in Monrovia. We had to close down because of Ebola in 2014. By the time I went back in 2015, I kind of realized that I wanted to do something a bit more sustainable. You know, when I didn't have the store, I didn't have an income. But if I had owned my manufacturing processes, then perhaps we would have been able to continue. I opened the factory in 2016, and that allowed me to have control over my manufacturing. It wasn't like a huge pool of people who were interested in sewing clothes, so finding employees was challenging, but you know, it's been very rewarding because the people who are interested see that there's a way out of poverty through hard work.
A lot of our kids' clothes are made in Ghana. So these pieces are hand batiked by some of the women that we work with in Ghana, Global Mamas. They do really cute kids' clothes, and like, this is really popular for us. We also have really cute baskets. I love these baskets. I wear the basket purses, they're really fun. And then the other bigger baskets can be for home goods. The hoops are made leftover cloth. So scraps from pieces that we made in this factory. So sometimes you can find a pair that's got the same. Like this one I know matches a handkerchief dress that we've had. But sometimes people just want something that they can wear that's bright with their jeans. So I feel like we really fill that void. Oh, this is the one that matches those hoops. So these are a top seller in our store, this flare sleeve pop crop. And it's made by Beatrice. Beatrice is an Ebola widow. She didn't know how to read or write. So, and then her community outcasted her because they thought she was gonna bring it to them. But now she earns an income with Bombshell. And so she pays for her daughter to go to school. Her daughter's gonna be the first formally educated person in their family.
My team is really, I love each and every one of them for their own different skills and life stories and the things that they're overcoming in order to continue to work with us. We all really lean on each other. We work together after you've worked with people for 5 years, you know? It's very easy to get used to each other and work as a family. Like, you're doing things side by side, as they say. It's been nice to see their evolution from, like, you know, Louise, who was living with her husband who was abusive, to her being the biggest breadwinner now, and so she can move to her own house. So that's a big deal when I go see her and visit her at her own home. And each time I go, she's done something different. Like, she'll have fixed her flooring or maybe have replaced and brought nice new doors or whatever, but she's building her home. So I go to see her at her home at least once a year when I'm back in Liberia, just to see how she's doing, to go see Blessing, whose mom sells Kool-Aid in the market. And, you know, the first time I went to see her when the economy was doing better, you know, her mom had built a store, like a little convenience store on the side of their house where people in the neighborhood could come buy drinks. But then when I went back and the economy was weaker, she had a leaky roof, the business wasn't as consistent, but I can see what's going on, and therefore I can see how to help people. Like, what are the problems that cash will solve, and what are the problems that, you know, we just need to see how the economy shapes and shifts. Liberia is a huge aid country. There's a lot of, like, foreign aid. And I kind of got to a point where I'm seeing so many people who have made all this money just by coming and saying, okay, I see what you need, or I'm an African expert, but I've been based in Europe, or, you know, I feel like aid needs to be redone at this point, because I don't think that it's helping. First of all, you need, we'll say that the countries that colonized specific African countries to kind of repay their debt, to be honest. And then if somebody is an African expert, then you know that you need to come sit down, listen, and try to offer solutions from within and not from on top. So for me, I didn't want to do anything that where, okay, here's a grant for this, or here's, I don't mind grants, but I wanted to make sure that people are earning things and not becoming dependent on, you know, right now we're in a time of crisis and here's quick money. So for us, it's very important to give somebody a skill, because then no matter what the situation is, they have that skill that they can fall back on. So wherever they may find themselves in the future, they always know that they can work. It's been very interesting to be in this space. At some point, I thought about getting a white co-founder just to, like, you know, say that I did. And to be honest, I mean, we still may need to at some point in order to really grow and scale. I always tell people, to be honest, that if I were white, our business would be bigger. It's the truth. There are so many white women in this space. And I think that there's something that people look at a white savior and think that they're more capable than somebody of color. It's unfortunate, but it's true. And then, to be honest, my education is the only thing that saves me. If Beatrice or Blessing came to anybody and said, I'm making clothes, somebody would give them a donation because they thought they were helping and being charitable, and then they'd feel good about what they've done. But they're not going to provide the opportunities or open the doors that have been opened for me just because my education is comparable to any of the white counterparts that have similar businesses. Latoya from Sustainable Home Goods, she's the first. And when I met her, I was like, because when people give a black woman a shot, if she blows it, they say, well, I tried, right? But if she had not done well, then they would not have taken a shot on me. Do you know what I mean? Let's say her store had to close. They'd be like, well, we tried a black business. But they don't feel that way about white businesses. If a white business closes, they're like, oh, well, it's very easy to find another white business owner to go with, to be honest. So when I met Latoya, I was like, you're the one who did it. You paved this way for us. And so I'm here, and then Dr. Key is there, and Pinky Cole is there, and there's a juice bar downstairs. And, you know, but it feels good to say that there are so many of us, because we couldn't shop here, much less own a business inside of it. So all of these things are very, very important to the ecosystem of Atlanta. So there's a lot of important work that's to be done just by connecting people. A lot of people come from very far to shop with us. These guys, they're based in Atlanta. Atlanta does influence everything. And then I do these tie-dyes. I just finished tie-dyeing crops that are gonna have that stamp on it. So it's really exciting. So we have three different greeting cards makers. We have cards that we make with our leftover fabric in Liberia. Then we have cards made by our friend Savannah, who is of Kindred Paper Company. She's based in Atlanta. And then we have just gotten in some hand-painted cards from a high school student. So it's just all about the different ways that you might enjoy to express your creativity. Well, I would like to open a second location within the next year, ideally in New York. I've been looking around at that. I'll be looking some more at that over the next couple months. I would like for us to continue to grow and expand. I want a bar in the middle and then, you know, the shopping all around it, because I feel like that is kind of our vibe. Like, I like that we're all a fun vibe, you know, and I want us to maintain that and continue to grow that. I would like for us to have more collaborations, you know, more designers that can work with us, more everything. I want more people to feel welcome in this space. I want more clients to come and feel comfortable trying clothes on. I want to see how we can grow and kind of shape people, like put people into colors. I feel like we've been in black long enough.